Welcome, everyone. This is Frank DeVay with Chaffin Associates. I'm here to welcome you all to our webinar, Legal and Tax Issues in Connection with Buying Distressed Assets. This webinar is part of a series that is focused on mergers and acquisitions involving privately held companies. It's a collaboration between Capital One Wealth Management, Chaffin Associates, and Baker Donelson. Baker Donelson is a global law firm and I've had great success working with. I'm going to introduce our panelists today from the global, the New Orleans office of Baker Donelson. First is Rob Wollfarth. He has been with Baker Donelson for 20, or has been practicing law for 20 years. He's a shareholder here. He specializes in tax mergers and acquisitions and other such business matters. He's a prolific writer of articles and various speaking engagements, graduate of NYU Law School and an undergraduate from Tulane University. On my right, and I know you can't see this, but he's on my right, obviously, Hank Arnold. Hank has been practicing law for 30 years, mostly transactional work. He's practiced bankruptcy law across the Gulf South from Houston to Mobile. His JD was earned from Loyola University, and he is a grad of LSU. It doesn't say what his major is. I'm suspecting it was in fun.
Thank you, Frank.
Thank you. So the first thing we're going to do is kind of just talk about distressed assets, but trying to make sure that everybody understands the backdrop. I think most of you who are on the seminar knows what's been going on historically. But we're going to talk about distressed assets, E&P assets, service company assets, offshore, reserves, and et cetera.
Yeah, and a couple of points here. I mean, obviously, we're going to get to the assets, and we're going to talk about the causes and effect and why we got here. But the type of assets that are in distress are basically assets held in energy companies. And because the company is in distress, then we think these assets should be considered distressed, and they may be available for purchase. And I think the background causes, obviously, lower commodity prices, and we'll get into that, but the lower commodity prices, you know, drives a reduction in cash flow, which then drives, you know, breaches of financial covenants, drives down the valuation of the company and the company's assets, and then a lot of these companies ramped up, so they're over leveraged and have a lot of debt. And where what ends up there is that the lenders are they're in default with their lenders. They've got to get forbearance. In exchange for forbearance, the lenders want something. What do they want? They want the debt paid down. And these are not entities that can be operationally reorganized. There's not a unit that's bad that you just sell off. It's a balance sheet issue, and in order to pay down the debt, you've got to sell something. So someone's problem is somebody else's opportunity, so it creates some opportunity in those for those distressed assets. I think where we are now is sort of a tale of two worlds. It really depends on where you are. If you're in the basins in Texas, things are actually doing okay there. If you're offshore, things are not doing so well at all. And so location is really a real key issue here. But there are some opportunities in this field with distressed assets and with distressed companies. And we'll talk about how we got there, what we're seeing in the bankruptcy world right now, and how we're going to move forward.
All right, now that we've whetted your appetite, let's go over some housekeeping matters. There's a place for you guys to submit your questions to us during the webinar. We're going to reserve 5 minutes at the end to answer the questions. You'll have access to a copy of our PowerPoint that you'll be viewing during the webinar. There's a survey for you to complete at the end. Please do this. It helps us to know whether or not our contact is valuable to you, and you know, we do love the criticism and comments. Finally, if there's any topic that we didn't cover or any topic that you'd like more detail in, don't hesitate to contact us. We'll be happy to provide in additional detail. You can contact us directly. I think that our contact information is made available in this presentation. So let's begin the webinar with the content of the webinar with with some background of what's going on in energy. Okay, so I think most people are familiar with what's going on, but this is a graphic way for me to depress you even further. At its high, oil was trading at about $112 a barrel, and over the course of the last 24, almost 36 months, it's just fallen off the cliff. Right now, we're looking at lows of, the low at its lowest point, it was 27, and right now it's trading in a range sort of like between 40-ish, 50-ish a barrel.
And I think prices are down 20% year to date, which is, I think there was some people thinking that 2017, the end of 2017 was going to look good. I think most people have pulled back on that prediction. So we're down over 20% this year. And then, Frank, look at the period when we, from June 12th, which is the first segment, 2012, to the, $100 a barrel all the way through when the Saudis turned on the spigot after Thanksgiving in 2014. In that price range, how easy was capital?
Well, right in the beginning, we coincidentally were in the markets with the deal, and we had it all priced up in September and sort of cratered around the day before Christmas Eve. So capital was flowing. I mean, if you remember, Haynesville was extremely hot. Everybody was into the shale fields and. And I guess around November of that year, the message was, we really like this deal, but we don't know how to price it anymore.
But before that, obviously, I think capital was pretty easy, funneled a lot of expansion and growth. We saw a historic number of vessels being built for offshore supply services. People were ramping up. No one thought the table it would fall off the cliff like it did.
Yeah, nobody predicted that. So the tail of the tape here is really production, and I know these charts are a little bit hard to read, but what we have here is a monthly crude oil production over the last 24, 30 months. The top line is the crude oil. And basically, it's been a pretty steady. Growth in production. This is U.S. Production. It's gone from 6,000 to almost 10,000 barrels a day, which is a huge increase. I know that Hank brought up the Saudis turning on the spigot. I think one of the biggest disruptors of supply in the markets has been the United States and the onshore, and the fact that we've gotten very, very efficient at producing oil. So the mantra drill baby drill really went both ways. It sort of made for great production, but sort of had a negative impact on the pricing.
I think that certainly that's true. The technological advances in fracking are really what drove U.S. production and continue to drive U.S. production. This production is all land-based. So if you look on the right, the increase is it's kind of the good, the bad, and the ugly. And the bad was the reduction in pricing, which we'll talk about, and we'll get into the other issues later on. But so this is a change in rig count by region for this year. So it shows some improvement, and that's again driven by advances in technology. At the height of production, there were 1,400 land-based drilling rigs in the United States. There are currently 450 land-based drilling rigs. And you see there is an uptick in the Permian basins and the other Texas basins primarily, and that's because of additional increases in technology and also cost. The first response of the U.S. major oil companies was to immediately demand in the downturn 20%, 10% across-the-board reductions by vendors. They had to comply if they were going to continue to do services, and that obviously had a trickle-down effect through the market. But it has gotten everybody leaner and meaner, and those prices have come down, and the cost of production have come down, and we'll talk about that in a minute.
Yeah. To me, the big story, this is just sort of another look at production, supply, demand dynamics in the market, particularly through 2013 first quarter to 2016, you'll see that from 2015 to 2016, you'll see that there's been an oversupply in the market. And I don't know if you can see, but the implied stock change, this is the bar charts down at the bottom. That number has been recast. I just got a new chart from EIA just yesterday, and it's more like the 2 million barrels per day stock change in positive direction during that period of time. And fourth quarter of 2016 bar chart should actually be around that 2 million barrels per day. So through that period of time, there's been a huge amount of overproduction. This has been going on for, 36 months now.
And you can see the dip right before where we are is when OPEC cuts came into play, and OPEC sort of held those cuts, but U.S. fracking did not. And as soon as the cuts came into play, pricing went up a little bit, but the fracking took off. And so U.S. production continued to climb and does continue to climb. The last report I saw is that even without any additional rigs, U.S. production will continue. DUCs was mentioned in that first slide. That's drilled and uncompleted wells. I believe that there are about 6,000 of those in the different Permian and Bakken basins. So that's 6,000 wells that have been drilled but have not been completed that can be turned on very quickly, very inexpensively, if there's any increase in price. So previously, the Saudis were sort of, and OPEC was the market maker, handling the ebbs and flows of the market. And when U.S. fracking and technology came online, we really took the Saudis out of that market maker position, and now they're still a wild card because they still control a significant amount of production. But it is U.S. land-based production that is the true wild card.
So this is what I'm finding really interesting.
This is what I call the good.
Yeah, this is the good.
This is the good.
And a couple of years back, 24 months or so ago, there was a great chart produced by an analyst out there that took a look at production break-even points throughout the entire spectrum from Saudi Arabia to Russia. And, most of the shale fields, as you can see here, used to fall in that almost $100 barrel with some of the stuff here, and then between $98 and $66 a barrel. Offshore, I think the dynamics, if my memory serves me properly, was between $75 and $80 a barrel. So there's been a reset, and everybody had sort of seen it coming because day rates for boats are down. Rigs are being laid down. Labor factor prices are gone down because there's a lack of utilization. So here's a microcosm of the shale fields and how over the last couple of years the market or the producers have gotten much more efficient at extracting oil from the shale fields.
And this is land-based, is not offshore, and offshore has not seen the same reduction, although there have been some. But that's really the ugly is going to be the offshore segment.
Well, I don't know. Hey. So the offshore segment is actually being repriced as well, and it shows up really dynamically here between 2016 and 2013. So in the acreage that was sold during the peak of the pricing. We had 1.9 million acres being sold. This year, in March, there was less than a million acres being sold. But what's really striking, too, is the price. There was a $1.3 billion spent as opposed to $275 million, and the per-acre price has dropped by almost 60%. So that's caused a reset, and people are actually talking about offshore being a break-even at 50 right now.
Just yesterday, BOEM, the Bureau of Energy Management, rejected 10 bids that were in the March sale. So in the March sale, there were only 28 producers participated in the March sale with 189 bids on 163 tracts. And like I said, 10 of those were rejected yesterday, and the government, the Department of Interior, through BOEM, said the value of those bids was insufficient to provide the public with fair market value for the tracts. The tracts will be reoffered in August in lease sale 249. So there's life offshore, but there's still just an incredible oversupply of equipment.
Yeah. And then we get a couple of quickies here. This is a new term that I've seen in the market. It's called aggressive stacking strategies. So that these offshore service vessels are being stacked, the utilization is way off. This is from Hornbeck's recent press release. The effective day rate for their boats, and these are all new state-of-the-art vessels, went from almost $20,000 a day to less than $9,000 a day in first quarter 2016, and the utilization rate has gone from 75% to 35%. Really, really tough.
And what separates this downturn from prior downturns, and in the olden days, we had, you know, equipment that the 170-foot boats. These boats are 200 to 300 feet. They are incredible capital investments. They are incredibly technologically advanced, and they cannot just be cold stacked. So here you have Hornbeck warm stacking them where they have crews running the vessels, and that's probably what's going to happen. The last number I saw was approximately 70% of the Gulf of Mexico fleet is stacked.
Yeah, so here's my last bit of depressing news for those out there. The CapEx budgets for all the majors are significantly down, and they continue to make pretty steep cuts. So the picture is more as Todd. I'm gonna quote Todd Hornbeck. He calls it an L-shaped recovery.
Lower, longer.
Lower, longer. All right. Here we go.
All right. So here's the vicious cycle. We have a reduction in commodity prices, reduction in cash flow. Capital budgets are going down. Stock prices are going down. Liquidity, reserves, everything is going down. And the end result is an increase in bankruptcy filings.
All right. So, Hank, let's talk about the extent of which we're in a buyer's market for distressed assets and what are the current market conditions that make this a buyer's market?
Yeah. So I have the bankruptcy slide up here. You see the number. This is from Haynes and Boones. They were the first people to come out and sort of track these bankruptcies. But the servicer bankruptcies are on the right. The E&P bankruptcies are on the left. And so there are opportunities. And, you know, what we've seen is the lenders in the offshore segment have been very patient because there's really nothing you can do with this collateral. If you wanted to buy some vessels, it would be an excellent time to go out there because you could buy vessels at a very, very good price now. Because the fracking has come back, the land-based equipment, there's a market for that. There's a shortage of employment. You know, a lot of people left the industry, and getting them back is going to be difficult. So one of the categories in the front on distressed assets we put was talent. And, you know, engineers are leaving the business, mariners are leaving the business. One way to get them is in these acquisitions. So we do know it's going to come up. I don't know when it's going to come up, but when it comes up, a lot of money will be made. So there are opportunities out there. We have not seen the first couple of private equity firms that jumped in on energy deals got burned. They came in too early. So they're sitting on the sidelines. There's a lot of dry powder out there. If you're trying to do a deal on the shelf, it's very tough to get capital on the shelf. Much easier. We see a big uptick in M&A in the Permian Basin and then the Texas opportunities. Wouldn't you agree with that, Frank?
I do, yeah. I see people, and there's a lot of people hovering. This little uncertainty over the last couple of weeks has sort of frightened some people off a little bit.
All right. The next slide is to kind of look at the bankruptcies and what the outcome has been. And we'll see. So we've seen these are some of the representative bankruptcies that have been filed on energy-related companies. You see just sale of assets. CalDive was one of the first out with a sale of assets. Dune Energy is interesting because the lender group thought the assets, which were basically reserves, were going to sell in the $60 million range. They sold for about $19 million, plus there was an assumption of P&A liability, plugging and abandonment and decommissioning liabilities there. The reorganizations on the right have all generally been debt to equity. The lenders end up coming out of the case owning it. More recent cases include Tidewater, Gulfmark will probably be debt to equity. Those plans are pending. We represent the debtor in Rooster Energy, a case we put in Lafayette 2 weeks ago. That will most likely be a debt to equity plan. Seen some other cases just get stalled. But a lot of times it's the lenders or the equity, the bondholders taking over the cases. So sort of to run through this quick, service bankruptcies, the service companies, there is a market for those assets as long as they're not offshore assets. Those cases are just similar to your traditional Chapter 11 cases. a lot of prepackaged deals where the lenders or the bondholders have agreed to certain treatment, and they go in with a plan support agreement, and the case is tried to push through the bankruptcy fairly quickly. So if the equipment is in the right location and the right type of equipment, there is a market for it. If it's not in the right location, i.e. if it's offshore, there's not much of a market. Midstream, what we're seeing in midstream, the biggest case was the Sabine case, which midstream companies are the ones that gather from the fields and move the product to the refineries. The Sabine case held that the pipeline agreements were not covenants running with the land. It was the New York court interpreting Texas law that sent all the midstream companies into a turmoil. The issue there was, could they reject those contracts, which is a remedy available under the bankruptcy code, in an effort to sort of renegotiate those contracts. So the midstream companies, there's been a lot of play with that. It seems to have settled down. But the end result is that you have to look at the state law to determine whether those are covenants that run with the land. So we've seen a lot of that. We've seen the vessel companies file. I believe there'll be more vessel companies filing. And so that's kind of a summary of where we are, what we're seeing in the bankruptcy context, and how we got here to this distressed process. And I think now.
Okay, great. Thanks, Hank. And in this segment of the webinar, Hank and Rob are going to go to describe some of the unique risks associated with buying distressed energy assets and legal techniques meant to address these both in and outside of bankruptcy.
Thanks, Frank. I'm Rob Wollfarth with Baker Donelson, as Frank mentioned earlier. I'm going to talk about protecting against common risks when if there is an opportunity to buy distressed assets. I'm going to discuss what those common risks are. To a large extent, the legal issues that the purchaser should investigate when purchasing distressed assets are really most of the same issues that arise in any asset acquisition. However, the probability that these legal issues, such as seller default under its existing contractual obligations or seller violation of law or more likely to materialize in this context given the seller's financial troubles. So I'm going to talk about the role of due diligence versus reps and warranties to deal with those risks. Certainly the mechanisms for addressing these legal issues in this context change somewhat as the seller's financial troubles may make the typical rep and warranty and indemnification package not worth the paper it's written on. So I'm also going to talk about alternative remedies for addressing breaches of reps and warranties when the assets acquired don't have the value that the purchaser expected. So going on to slide 16, one of the common risks in this situation, obviously you have a tremendous amount of creditor involvement. So you're dealing with, as a purchaser, and this is really from the purchaser's perspective, the creditor's right to rescind the sale. And I mean a right that's beyond any contractual rights, breach of covenant, remedies for breaches of covenants that the lender may have, the creditor may have in the loan documents. This right stems in most states from some form of a fraudulent transfer law. And the creditor's rights under, and generally that gives the creditor the right to annul the debtor's sale of assets and possibly recover from the transferee. Now, that the terms associated with that right obviously vary from state to state, but generally it applies to two kinds of transactions. The intentional fraud situation where a seller intentionally attempts to hinder or delay or defraud its creditors. And this is called commonly actual fraudulent transfers. And then the other transactions where a creditor might have a right to annul a sale of distressed assets is where there wasn't intentional fraud, but the seller receives less than reasonably equivalent value for the distressed assets. And also that transaction causes the debtor to become insolvent or increases the debtor's insolvency. That's generally how the fraudulent transfer law works in most jurisdictions. Using Louisiana as an example, since that's where we are, that action is called a revocatory action. And really in Louisiana, fraud is irrelevant, whether the seller negligently or intentionally acted. The condition that triggers the creditor's right to annul the transaction in Louisiana is any transaction that the debtor engages in that causes or increases the debtor's insolvency. So obviously an example would be a transaction where the seller receives less than fair value or fair market value for its assets. And the other condition, that the seller is insolvent or becomes insolvent, means that the seller's liabilities exceed the total of its fairly appraised assets. Now, as I said, the creditor's remedy in this case is to annul the sale. Now, in many jurisdictions, there is some link to whether or some condition that the purchaser of the assets acted, you know, in bad faith or known or should have known. In Louisiana, good faith, there's really not a purchaser good faith standard. But if the transferee of the assets knew or should have known that it would cause the seller's insolvency, then the transferee can only recover what it paid to the seller if that payment inured to the benefit of the creditors. On the other hand, under Louisiana law, if the purchaser did not know that the transaction would cause the seller's insolvency, then the transferee can recover as much as it paid to the seller. And lack of knowledge by the purchaser of the seller's insolvency in Louisiana is presumed when the purchaser pays at least 4/5 of the value of the assets. And this right in Louisiana of revocatory action is limited in the sense that a creditor cannot annul a transfer that's made in the seller's regular course of business. So a simple example would be the seller selling inventory in the regular course of business versus selling substantially all of its assets, which is an extraordinary transaction. In Louisiana, and again, this varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, but in Louisiana, the creditor has the lesser of 1 year of learning of the transfer or 3 years after it occurs to bring that action to annul the transaction. Now, as of August 1st, for transactions in Louisiana closing after August 1st, 2013, there's a fraud exception to that outside three-year period. If fraud is involved, then there is no limitations, period. And based on when that law went into effect, August 1st, 2013, we saw as of last August the three-year period ending for transactions. And so now we move into a period where creditors are looking to see if they can go back more than 3 years and annul transactions based on a finding of fraud. And with little interpretation of fraud, obviously the creditors won't be aggressive and potentially try to interpret the law as including not just actual fraud but constructive fraud, where it wasn't necessarily intentional on the part of the seller to defraud the creditors. So what can purchasers, parties to the transaction, do to avoid this significant risk in the distressed asset context? Well, certainly one of them is a solvency opinion by a financial firm that establishes that the seller is, in fact, not insolvent at the time of the transaction. Also, it has become widely accepted across the country as establishing fair value, a fairness opinion. This came really out of the Delaware courts in the 80s. And so now obtaining a fairness opinion can go a long way to establishing that reasonable fair value was paid for the assets. Now, fairness opinions receive some criticism because it's not an appraisal. It's simply an opinion that the transaction is within a range of values encompassing financial fairness. Obviously, market mechanisms such as auctions, if the sale is subject to an auction or an actual valuation, would be stronger evidence of fair value and have a better chance of avoiding rescission.
I want to ask a question to you, Rob, before you move forward on this. What about situations where, you know, obviously businesses sell assets all the time that are obsolete or they don't use, what does a seller without looking through to a company have with respect to protections when doing a transaction? Let's say they buy a couple of
remedies for it
without you know, because then, you know, they have to worry about the creditor coming back upon them, presumably as long as 3 years down the road.
We're going to talk about the alternative remedies, but, you know, certainly obtaining possibly both a solvency opinion and a fairness opinion would cover a lot of bases. And you know, I think a purchaser can rely heavily on that. But should those fail and they should they incur costs due to challenges from creditors, there are alternative remedies in this situation that take on greater importance than a non-distressed situation. I'll talk about this in a second.
Okay.
So in addition to the creditor's right to rescind for fraudulent transfer type situations or in Louisiana or revocatory action, In the distress context, you have a number of other potential risks. A few include, you know, the seller's failure to meet obligations under joint operating agreements and other partnership joint venture arrangements, which makes sense. I mean, if the seller's in financial trouble, it's going to fall short of meeting some obligations. Also, a purchaser should look at what is the wherewithal of the seller's partners and joint venturers. Are they capable of meeting their obligations under the seller's contracts in the market, as Hank and Frank described it? A potentially catastrophic problem could be environmental issues that the seller hasn't dealt with due to its financial troubles. On past deals, our environmental lawyers have pointed out that not only may this completely devalue the assets that have been acquired, but some remediation obligations and the cost associated with those may transfer over to the purchaser. So that's a big one to ferret out in connection with a distressed asset acquisition. Obviously, there are obligations that the seller has to potentially to properly terminate non-producing wells. There are federal requirements regarding offshore wells, drilling commitments, leases that are expiring, or contracts that are lapsed. These could all be potential issues in a distressed asset acquisition. And so, as Frank pointed out, what do you do to mitigate these risks, which are heightened in this context? And obviously, we're assuming that you're not going to be able to turn back to the seller if the seller no longer has much creditworthiness. I think generally, due diligence takes on a heightened importance, a greater role in distressed asset acquisitions, compared to relying mostly or primarily on reps and warranties and recovering damages from the seller post-closing. As we say, the seller may be judgment-proof at this point if it's in serious financial trouble. And really, I say this with respect to all asset acquisitions, not just in the distress context, but even if the buyer is able to be made whole for breaches of reps and warranties, that is, recover from the seller, in some cases, it may not really put the assets or the business back to the level of profitability it would have had if the breach had not occurred, meaning if the assets had not had the defect that they turned out to have. In many cases, particularly when you have a distressed seller that wants to rid itself of its troubles, the seller's not going to be very willing to give up a very comprehensive package of reps and warranties. So that may limit the reliance on reps and warranties in this context as well. And, you know, the practical effects of due diligence is that it allows the purchaser to discover the risks prior to closing, elect not to close, or to do something prior to closing to minimize the effect, such as renegotiating the purchase price or excluding some troubled assets, rather than simply taking them on blindly and hoping to recover after the fact. And just generally, it may be less of a hassle and less expensive, as we pointed out with a few examples like environmental, to simply discover a problem in due diligence before the transaction closes and have the seller cure it if possible or make arrangements for it to be cured. Now, when we talk about due diligence, obviously we're talking about, you know, a real methodical investigation of the legal, financial, and strategic aspects of the seller's business and its assets, information that can't be obtained publicly. And this means, you know, for example, doing such things as reviewing all of the seller's contracts, especially those that the purchaser is intending to acquire, to determine what are the seller's obligations under those contracts, what are the other party's obligations that the purchaser is now going to be dealing with, and what constitutes a breach of those agreements? And are those agreements even remaining effective at the time of the transaction, or have they lapsed? Investigating the counterparties in this environment is extremely important. The seller may have met all of its obligations, but perhaps the counterparties to its agreements have not, which leaves the purchaser in a bad spot if it assumes those contracts and those relationships. Certainly on the environmental side, that's always a big issue, obtaining reports from experts that will reveal the existence of environmental problems and the required remediation before the transaction closes. And reviewing whether the seller has any obligations regarding its assets under federal and state law, beyond what its contracts state, but what obligations does the law require, as we said, things like terminating wells or obligations for offshore properties that perhaps the seller hasn't met. Now, even with the heightened importance of due diligence in connection with buying distressed assets, there still is a remaining need for reps and warranties. Even with the most thorough due diligence, a solid package of reps and warranties are needed because you can't discover everything. A purchaser can't discover everything through due diligence, especially things that may happen to the assets or natural events that may happen in the future. And despite the seller's financial distress, if the purchaser is able to create a source for post-closing recovery, and I'll talk about these in a moment, such as holding back portions of the purchase price or escrowing purchase price, then the purchaser will want a good set of reps and warranties to provide a basis for recovering from those sources. So comprehensive reps and warranties are still needed, I think, even in this context, and can serve as preliminary due diligence, frankly. Reps that the seller is unwilling to give may tip the buyer off as to where the trouble spots are.
And another comment, because of the nature of the assets we're talking about, their energy or maritime assets, you've got Oil Well Lien Act in Louisiana, you've got a similar act in Texas, you also have maritime liens on any vessels or maritime equipment. So maritime liens are totally inchoate. There's no requirement that they be filed with the Coast Guard, the National Vessel Documentation Center, technically, but they are permissive. So those liens can be out there that you don't know about. So there is absolutely, because of the nature of the assets we're talking about, there's a heightened due diligence requirements.
So as a buyer, when you ask for reps and warranties in this situation, a giggle isn't the proper answer for the seller, right?
Well, it depends on the zone, where the debtor is in the zone of insolvency or where your seller is. Obviously, pre-bankruptcy, you have to anticipate that a bankruptcy could be filed, and then are those going to be worth the paper they're written on, as Rob said. When you're in the context of a bankruptcy, it changes, and I'll talk about that a little bit. But, you know, when you're in the zone of insolvency, you just have to assume that you're not getting much in the form of reps and warranties, or that there's not going to be a recourse, because your claim for that is generally going to be an unsecured claim, and claims for contribution and indemnity under the bankruptcy code are generally disallowed in total. So you may have a great contractual claim, but there may not be a way to enforce it.
So now to answer Frank's earlier question, so let's suppose you have a breach of those reps and warranties. What are the remedies in this context that the purchaser might have? So, as we said, a mere right to recover from the seller through indemnification for breaches of those reps and warranties may be all but worthless if the seller is financially distressed. Let's start with that assumption. So what are some alternatives? Certainly, a holdback of the purchase price is one option. Assuming that the purchaser has assured itself through due diligence that there are no catastrophic claims, in other words, claims that would say to the purchaser, we're not even doing this deal, then it may be adequate for the purchaser to simply withhold a portion of the purchase price for a period of time, and that's negotiated, to cover any breaches that are discovered post-closing. That wouldn't necessarily kill the deal, but for which the purchaser would want to recover, which are material. And typically I see that period lasting 12 to 18 months. I've had deals where the holdback lasts 3 years. I mean, that's a heavily negotiated item. Now, on the seller side, the seller may say, well, that's fine. We can have a holdback. I like the amount. I like the period over which you're going to hold it, but I don't trust you to hold it, purchaser. So what can we do to assure the seller that when that period's over and you haven't discovered any breaches of reps and warranties, that cash is going to be there to be distributed as a final payment of the purchase price? So in that case, the parties may agree to put the money in escrow. And generally, that assures the parties that the money will be there. It's usually with an independent third-party escrow agent like a bank. And then either in the purchase agreement or a separate escrow document, the parties agree under what conditions that money is going to be released to either party. And then I think it's extremely important in the purchase and sale documents to explicitly provide for offsets. And what I mean by that, so if the purchase price is to be paid in installments, for example, the purchaser should have a right to offset those installment payments for discovered breaches of reps and warranties. And obviously there are all sorts of terms of negotiating connection with that. Who determines whether there's a breach? Who determines whether, you know, to what extent, well, how much should be paid out? Or another situation would be if the purchase price is paid as an earnout over several years based on any number of factors, the profitability or the revenue streams of the assets post-closing. There should be explicit provision, at least if you're the purchaser, for offsetting those payments under the earnout with any breaches of reps and warranties that are discovered, at least for a certain period of time, maybe coextensive with the period of the earnout, maybe a lesser period of time. And so that's a way for the purchaser to basically help the seller satisfy its indemnification obligations when the seller would not otherwise be able to do so because of financial distress.
And Rob, these holdbacks and escrows, if the company subsequently goes into bankruptcy, are there clawback provisions or is this sort of parsed out?
Yeah, so I'm going to turn it over to Hank now because Hank's going to layer on top of all these sort of generic transactional issues what happens in bankruptcy.
Yeah, specifically with the holdback and the escrow, the question becomes whether the escrow is property of the estate. So if the escrow is properly documented, it will not be considered property of the estate, and you'll have recourse to that. And so, to step back and just some general premises on the bankruptcy. So the filing of the bankruptcy creates an estate, and that's all property and causes of action that the debtor owns. The debtor then has the powers provided under the bankruptcy code, which are generally preferences and avoidance actions, and we'll talk about that in a second. But the bankruptcy code is premised on two fundamentals, that similarly situated creditors get treated the same. And that the other key issue is, and that's the absolute priority rule, that everybody in the same class gets the same. So and unsecured creditors come first, equity comes last. Secured creditors with respect to their collateral come first with respect to that collateral. Their claim gets really transferred into a claim for a monetary judgment. But the key issues in the bankruptcy context, and we'll get to them, are really the actions that Rob referenced, the revocatory action, is very similar to the avoidance action in a bankruptcy context, which is the fraudulent conveyance action. The key issue is the same issue, whether the debtor receives reasonably equivalent value. And so valuation and proof of valuation are exactly the key. We had a recent case where we took an asset through a dash-on, which is a deed in lieu for common law people, a dash-on en paiement, a French civil term, and we took it in exchange for our debt. And the key issue there was the person we were taking it from was in financial difficulty, and so we documented that and got a very strong appraisal as to the value so that if it was challenged after the bankruptcy, we could prove that we gave reasonably equivalent value to it, which was the satisfaction of a portion of our judgment or our claim. And so that's very, very important. The other key issue is preferences. So the bankruptcy code assumes that transactions made within 90 days prior to the filing of the bankruptcy give you preferential treatment. The concept is you pay your friends when you're going down. For example, it has some unintended consequences. If you get a judgment and you go record that judgment within the 90 days prior to the bankruptcy, that's generally considered a preference because you got to move ahead. You moved from an unsecured creditor into a secured creditor. So in dealing with distressed companies, as a creditor, you really want to watch your payments and make sure your payments are paid timely. There are a number of defenses, including new value and ordinary course, which are beyond the scope of this. But if you're dealing with a company that's distressed, you want to look at the payment history and make sure that you're being paid in accordance with general business terms. Now, the slide we have here is 363 sales, and so that's the vehicle pursuant to which assets in a bankruptcy context are acquired. 363 is a section of the bankruptcy code that allows the debtor to sell assets free and clear. And so if you're acquiring, a lot of times in a very thorny situation, you may actually want the debtor to file bankruptcy because the protections you're going to get out of the bankruptcy are better. Bankruptcy is a very public process. There are lots of players and participants. You have the debtor. You have the bankruptcy court, obviously. The United States trustee oversees the administration of these cases. And then you also have an unsecured creditors committee that can be appointed. And sometimes there can be a creditors committee appointed for the bondholders. So 363 is the vehicle to do this, and it also allows the debtor, 365 allows the debtor to assume executory contracts. So you could purchase these assets through a 363 sale from the debtor, and you can also get some corresponding contract rights that go along with that by having the debtor assume and assign those contract rights. And so that's the process. The pros and cons. Go back. We're running out of time, so I'll go through the pros and cons. Buying out of bankruptcy, the pro is it's public. That's also a con because people get to see what you paid for something and get to see the whole terms. An advantage of it is it's free and clear. This was thought to be pretty well established. The General Motors bankruptcy case that was denied by the Supreme Court kind of makes a question about successor liability issues. That case was specifically the ignition switches, and when GM was old GM versus new GM, the question is whether they gave adequate notice to the car owners of the ignition switch problem or whether they hit it. So right now there's a question as to whether that successor liability is going to be paid by GM or whether new GM can be saddled with that. So that's certainly an issue that there's some doubt upon that. The process in the 363 sale, you know, generally you would be a stalking horse. So you would be able to control the process a little bit. You'd be able to draft your purchase agreement. You'd be able to make everybody else comply with your purchase agreement. You can get a breakup fee. You can get other protections in the stalking horse process. But it is a public process, and there is always a potential for upset bids, and it does take a while. So there, you lose some control, but you control the process. You can control the documentation, but there's always a possibility that someone can come in and bid more than you bid. As I said, it's a structured process, and it requires notice to all the creditors, an opportunity to be heard, a hearing. A lot of times financial advisors will be involved. Some of these sale processes are pretty complicated with people in a bunch of different rooms, with the financial advisor going and trying to solicit the highest and best offer. That is the creditor's duty, is to execute its business judgment and get the highest and best offer. So when you have a lot of different types of assets, sometimes it's hard to tell what the highest and best offer is. If you're assuming this liability, or you're assuming a lease liability as well, or you're assuming the environmental liabilities, but you're paying less cash, and that's really what you get a lot of contest about that. And so, you know, like I said, it's a public process. For the lender, it's good because the process allows for credit bidding. That credit bidding can be limited for cause. We've seen that in a recent case involving a newspaper where there was some evidence of collusion, and the court limited the secured party's credit bidding for cause. So that's a potential out there. But generally, the secured lender is able to credit bid its mortgage. The cons, very limited warranty. You may get a lot of due diligence. You may get what you want in the documents. You may be able to make other people use the form of document that you submit and is approved by the court. But the recourse after you buy the assets is extremely limited, and there's nobody there because the bankruptcy is either going to be, converted to a Chapter 7 is what we're seeing now a lot, or there's just no one there. So the other con, Braniff. So Braniff was a Fifth Circuit case that said that you can't sell all or substantially all the assets of a company pursuant to a 363 sale because you need to do that in the plan confirmation process. The plan confirmation process provides additional protections to the creditors, and the Fifth Circuit reasoned that selling all of the assets, which Braniff was an airline, if everybody remembers, selling all the assets and just leaving the carcass for the bankruptcy court to resolve really wasn't consistent with the strategy and purposes of the bankruptcy code. We've seen a significant trending away from that concept. The Bankruptcy Reform Act, BAPSIFA, has sped the process up significantly. We are seeing more and more 363 sales, conversions to a liquidating trust where the assets, remaining assets, a lot of them are the preference actions, are sent to the liquidating trust for the benefit of the unsecured creditors. Another con in the process is just potential delays. People can come in and object to the process. If there's a problem, you could have the hearing could be continued. You could have a lot of different people come in. You have the potential for someone to come in and bid who can't fulfill the terms of the bid. And of course, one of the biggest negatives to this is obtaining financing out of a bankruptcy sale can be extremely difficult and challenging if you do not have cash to come in and play. And in the bankruptcy context, cash is king. You have to have cash to bid. None of these sales are done with any kind of financing terms, so you have to get third-party financing. And what's going to happen is the lender is going to come in and second-guess the bidding procedures, the notices that were given, whether you satisfied due process, giving notice to all the other creditors, like in the GM case, to make sure that there's no successor liability. So you're going to get a whole other set of eyes and lawyers looking at the deal, and that can be complicating. So that's sort of just a summary of the bankruptcy sale process. What we're seeing now, in the beginning I talked about, most of these cases are conversion of debt to equity or a 363 sale of assets, and that's how you want to structure it if you're buying assets out of the bankruptcy. The successor liability issue is not perfect, but it's still the best vehicle to get these assets out of the court and to get them out of the debtor's hands with the best situation that you can.
Thanks, Hank. This is Rob again, and I'm just going to spend a few minutes in this very last segment discussing some of the tax issues that an acquirer is going to face with respect to distressed assets. And really what I'm talking about in with respect to this discussion is equity firms and others who are looking to actually buy debt at a discount and think that, you know, there may be a benefit there to buying debt, existing debt of the owners of energy assets at a low cost. And so the first tax issue I'm going to talk about is the impact of market discount, an original issue discount. What I mean when I say market discount, a simple example, let's suppose the debtor's the principal amount of the debt at maturity is 1,000, and an acquirer comes in and gets the debt at for 800. So the market discount, the difference there is $200. Or in the second situation, let's suppose that debt was originally issued at a discount. In other words, the amount payable at maturity, the difference between the amount loaned and the amount payable at maturity was more than the required interest payments under IRS code and regulations. So there's a gap there. In both of those situations, an acquirer is going to have to recognize taxable income to the extent of that discount. Now, the difference between market discount, where the acquirer buys the debt at a discount, and original issue discount, is that original issue discount must be recognized as taxable income over the remaining term of the debt, whereas market discount, the acquirer can elect to recognize it over the remaining term, ratably over the remaining term of the debt, or simply pay the tax when the debt matures or the debt is sold. And that, in both of these cases, you could think of it as being treated as interest. It's going to be ordinary income. And I think the real kicker here for the acquirer to consider, especially large transactions, large acquisitions of debt, is that the tax is due whether payments are made or the acquirer has the cash to pay the tax on the discount. So that could be something detrimental to the acquirer that needs to be thought out before the debt is acquired to determine whether it really is an opportunity. The next thing is, obviously, it's very common, is restructuring of the debt terms. And frequently, distressed companies will negotiate with creditors or acquirers of the debt to modify the terms of the debt to do things like increase the term, raise the interest rate on the creditors to the benefit of the creditor, adjust covenant terms, or otherwise make debt service obligations more manageable. The tax issue here is looking collectively at all of those modifications to the debt. If they are determined to be significant, as defined in the Internal Revenue Code and the regulations, then there will be a deemed exchange of the debt for new debt, even if there was no actual exchange. And if the creditor's basis in the debt is less than the face amount of the debt, or in the case of publicly traded debt, the fair market value of the debt, then that difference is, again, going to result in taxable income. So another scenario we have in this context is conversion of debt to equity as a means of resolving some of the distressed asset owner's financial woes. If a creditor forgives all or part of a debt, then the debtor generally has cancellation of indebtedness income, so taxable income from the amount that's reduced or the forgiveness of the debt entirely. Now, there are some exceptions. So if the debtor is insolvent or the discharge occurs in bankruptcy, generally that's going to be exception to the taxable income rule. But also, debt can be converted to equity without taxation to the debtor or the creditor. So let's look at those scenarios for just a minute. Let's assume we have a debt for equity exchange and the debtor is a corporation. If an existing shareholder is the creditor and contributes the corporation's debt back to the corporation, essentially canceling it, in this context, under the rules, the corporation is treated as having satisfied the debt with an amount of money equal to the shareholder's adjusted basis in the debt. So therefore, the shareholder does not recognize gain or loss. The corporation will not recognize cash cancellation of indebtedness income in this case unless the principal amount of the debt exceeds the shareholder's basis in the debt. So that generally can be a tax-free exchange in the corporate context. there's a planning opportunity here, because if the creditor is not an existing shareholder and contributes the debt to the corporation in exchange for stock, so debt for equity swap by an unrelated creditor, the debtor corporation is treated as having satisfied the debt with an amount of money equal to the fair market value of the stock. And the corporation will recognize taxable income in that context only if the fair market value of the stock issued to the creditors less than the principal amount of the debt. So that can be planned to avoid any taxation and relieve the debtor corporation of a financial burden. Now, the treatment of the creditor of this case, in this case, is a little different. In the case of the debt for equity swaps, the tax treatment of the creditor receiving the stock depends on whether the exchange otherwise qualifies for non-recognition treatment under the Internal Revenue Code. If it does not qualify for some non-recognition provision, then the creditor will recognize gain or loss equal to the difference between fair market value of the stock received and the basis in the debt. Now, if we look in the partnership context, when a debtor partnership transfers a capital or profits interest to a creditor in satisfaction of recourse or non-recourse debt, the partnership is treated as having satisfied the debt with an amount of money equal to the fair market value of the interest. So as long as those two things are equal, again, we don't have cancellation of indebtedness income charged to the partnership, which essentially is then passed through to all of the owners. And in addition, there's a provision that allows the parties to elect to treat the partnership interest, that is, exchange for the debt, as equal to its liquidation value if certain conditions are met. Now, there are a lot of related party rules in the Internal Revenue Code, and one applies in this context as well. You can imagine there have been a number of situations where, in order for a seller to relieve itself of some of its debt obligations to unrelated creditors, the owners of the company have said, we'll go acquire the debt, and hey, we'll just cancel it. We'll contribute it to the company, and under the rules I just discussed, normally that contribution by the shareholder would be tax-free. But the code says that the owners of the debtor corporation or partnership may attempt, if they attempt to acquire third-party debt, if they are related to their entity based on level of ownership, then the acquisition of that debt by the related person is going to be treated as though the entity acquired it. And what that means is essentially that it's been canceled and the entity realizes cancellation of indebtedness income. So even though the shareholder or the partner will have acquired the debt and technically swapped it in what would otherwise be a tax-free exchange, if it was held by an unrelated creditor, because the owner is related a certain way to the entity, it's still going to yield cancellation of indebtedness income. So those are just a few of tax issues that sellers and purchasers of debt, anyway, in this environment face. So that really concludes our presentation. Any final thoughts, Frank and Hank, on market conditions?
I have a little question about the last section here with respect to incurring an income event for taxation purposes. If a company is underwater equity-wise, and I saw that in one of the deals that we did, the appraised value of the assets was significantly below the face value of the loan. Explain to me how, or to the audience, how that works out with, banks will have to take a haircut eventually on these things, and how does that affect a buyer, whether it be related party or unrelated party, from a tax point of view?
Well, remember, a key exception to the cancellation of debtor's income was that if the debtor is insolvent or that discharge occurs in bankruptcy, then you don't have cancellation of debtor's income. Now, if the debtor is fortunate enough not to be insolvent or not to be in bankruptcy, then you're possibly, in order to relieve the debtor, talking about some sort of restructuring. And again, remember, if the restructuring is too significant, you're changing terms, interest, term of the debt, interest rates, you could end up causing a taxable exchange of the debt, a deemed exchange. Otherwise, you could have unrelated creditors or even owners that are creditors simply swapping the debt, and those can be structured as tax-free.
And a third-party buyer, as long as they're independent and they're not part of management, should get a new basis on the assets if they're buying an asset sale. And the only time that we see – that's interesting because, a lot of times you want to structure it as an asset sale so you don't get those liabilities. I mean, where we in the past have seen that not happen, particularly in bankruptcy cases, was gaming cases where the license was really the important asset. And, you know, you couldn't license technically was not transferable, but the state actually allowed that process to kind of work through the bankruptcy. So if there are contractual rights or licenses or permits, then you have to assume those. And so that's one of the benefits of a bankruptcy is that you can pull the executory contracts, not maybe governmental-type licenses, but you can pull executory contracts and pull them with the asset and the transfer. But through the bankruptcy, the buyer should get a stepped-up new basis or stepped down.
All right, Hank, Frank, thanks for joining me on this
webinar.
Thanks, everyone, for listening. I see we have no questions from the audience, so that concludes our webinar. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you all.